Here's something I saw in the thrift store a couple months ago, and as soon as I saw it, I knew I had to pick it up because it's just emblematic of 1970s hi-fi stereo component styling, even though it really is just a glorified clock radio. But I call it the 1970s in a box. Especially this front panel here, which has a wonderful array of knobs and buttons and switches and a cassette recorder, an 8-track player, and an LED readout for the clock and radio. And then, of course, there's the wonderful fake wood grain veneer on the sides and top, as it even has a sticker pointing out wood grain vinyl veneer. I believe that was actually required by law in the US. If it was not real wood, you had to put a sticker on it pointing that out. And it also has this advertisement sticker on top, which would have been used for if this was on display in a store. People could walk up to it and read all its features. You can see it's the IMA cassette and 8-track digital entertainment system, featuring digital frequency display, LED electronic clock, play/record stereo cassette, auto eject 8-track player, AM/FM stereo radio, and built-in speakers. And I like here, it actually tells you how to remove the label and to polish the cabinet afterwards to remove the residue. That's definitely something you don't see on modern equipment that comes with stickers all over it. On the back it gives the model number, PS2500, and it says IMA was a Craig company. There were actually several different models of these systems from IMA Craig, and they were also sold under the Hanamex brand name, which I believe was also sold in Europe. So if you're looking for one of these over there, look for a Hanamex. It probably will be under that name. There was the PS1000, which had the 8-track player, but not the cassette, and also had a regular analog slide rule tuning dial. There was the PS2000, which Clydesite did a video about, which had the cassette recorder, but not the 8-track, and also had a analog tuning dial. And then there was the PS2200, which looked identical to this, and had the same features, except they had a black faceplate. And I found an ad for that in the December 1980 issue of Popular Science magazine. It was being sold by DAC, which was the company that bought out and resold a lot of products that were closeouts and overstocks and other things like that. So they were probably clearing out the last remaining inventory of that model in late 1980 for $159. They called it the Mood Maker. And I love the description they started out with here. You're sitting at your desk, soft, beautiful music in full stereo is gently caressing you. You feel your tensions melt, your mind clears, and you're ready to take on the world. They also called it the latest technology in micro stereo. It is now possible to produce the sound of a full-size stereo in the space of an ordinary radio. I also found a PS3000 sold under the Hanamex brand name, which was a lot more like a traditional stereo receiver, but still had the 8-track player and built-in LED clock. And also there was a variant of this PS2500 model that Cassette Master did a video about, which had a green LED display and also had controls for an alarm clock feature, which this one does not have. So here is the PS2500 from IMA Craig, the 1970s in a box. So let's give it a try here. These are the built-in speakers I'm using right now. It also has jacks on the rear for external speakers with a switch to select them. And you can see on the display there, this is not actually a digital tuner. It's just a digital readout. The tuning dial is still conventional analog tuning, so it's just counting the frequency of the radio tuner, and that's why sometimes it sort of jumps back and forth between different numbers. It can get surprisingly loud. Also has a tone control.
Was used, right? Well, you know, these technologies are extremely modular, so you can build an AI model for recognizing objects.
Also,
it can be used to, you know, say recognizing shoes. It can be used.
ίχνο είναι περίπου σε γυναίκες οι οποίες έχουν κανονικό βάρος πριν την εγκυμοσύνη.
It's all Greek to me. This is actually having surprisingly good reception today. Normally the reception on this is not that great. It's just using one of those clips to use the power cord as the FM antenna.
20 years old. No, you will not.
A very old man whinging. Good grief. No idea what this station is. It really is just an old man whining. I've never heard anything like it.
Postprandial glucose testing. None of that is acceptable to me.
There's something this would have been playing when it was new.
On this island, get your thinking.
Unfortunately, I can't play more than a few seconds of each song because even YouTube on their official support page now admits you can get copyright claims on your video for just a few seconds of music. They actually put it in writing. So it's official policy now. There you can see the FM stereo indicator. And since this is an analog tuner with a digital readout, it can go far beyond the normal range of a digital tuner, up to 109.2 on FM and on AM. Well, it doesn't support the expanded band because that was not invented yet, but it goes up to 1654. Let's see what's on AM here. There's the AM oldies station around here.
So Jen, how old are you?
I'm 40.
Okay, terrific. There are different...
Never ask a woman her age. Let's see how low it goes on AM. 517. And on FM, 86.9. You won't see on a digital tuner. So that's it for the radio tuner. I like how when you turn it off for a few seconds there, the frequency counter sort of goes wacko and displays completely irrelevant numbers before it returns to the clock. Now let's try out the cassette player. This is a very common mechanism found in 1970s and early 1980s stereo systems. I guess this was sort of the old school predecessor to the Tanishin mechanism, which became common in the late 80s. This was a very crude and clunky mechanism, but also quite reliable. You see a lot of solid metal parts in there. When I first got this, it needed new belts, and it still does, but I gave it some temporary life left by boiling the belt. That's where you take out the belt and stick it in boiling water for a couple minutes, and that shrinks it a little bit and makes it a little bit more elastic, but that's not really a permanent fix, because you can see when I try to fast forward it, it just goes very slowly. Although rewinding is fine. So it still needs new belts, but for now, it's functional.
You will be positive. You will be strong. You will automatically relax. Yes. You will love life. You will feel yourself becoming calm. You will be good to yourself. You will find it easy being good to yourself. You will deserve to be happy. You will be mellow. You will see yourself relaxing. You will repeat in your mind everything you hear on this tape. You will repeat in your mind everything you hear on this tape.
Okay, enough of that. One quirk about this Well, let's do a Doug DeMuro style. Here's another quirk and feature of this deck. If you fast forward, you could pause the fast forwarding. It's the first deck I've ever seen that does that. The pause works on fast forward, not just play. You can see it stopped, and I let go, and it starts again. Hit pause, it stops. It doesn't do that on rewind. You can rewind while it's paused. But the pause works not only on play.
Exactly as you want it.
And also record, but also fast forward.
There are so many different types of programs in a variety of formats. You'll be enjoying your personal programmer for years and years to come. Guided imagery programs can take you to new destinations.
Here's something that I found the tape for, but I did not find the device itself. It's the Personal Programmer by Brainstorm Technologies. I looked this up. There's no record of this existing anywhere online. So if anybody can find me a Personal Programmer, let me know. I'd love to do a video about it. Or if you have one and you want to do a video about it, I can give you this tape. Because on the other side, listen to this. So it uses a four-track head. One side plays the music and voices, other side plays electronic tones that are some kind of digital control of whatever this thing is doing. Now for the 8-track, let's put in our disco tape from December 31st, 1977 by M. Mangus, tape number 1. This is a little bit special for an 8-track player because it's auto-eject. Just push a button and it slowly pops out by itself. And then you can stick it back in if you want. That's why it has this feature here, auto-eject. You can have it automatically eject after just one program or up to 4 programs, or on the last setting, it'll be continuous. So, let me see, if I put on 1, and I change the program, see it, then it automatically ejects. So I'll put on continuous. This 8-track player needs some work, because you can see the number 3 LED is not working. And then if I try to change the program again, it doesn't work. It gets stuck. I think it may have broken plastic in there, which is a very common problem with these 8-track players, which were actually manufactured by Tanishin. That was their very first product in the 1970s, or at least their first consumer tape product, was an 8-track mechanism, which became the standard for all 8-track players, pretty much, from the mid-1970s until they stopped making these things. I believe Radio Shack was the last to ever sell a new 8-track player in 1990. I actually did a video about that model. On the front it has left and right microphone inputs. There's all the controls that went over. And here's the function selector, AM, FM, auto, which is sort of an outdated term. The auto just means that whenever you tune in a FM station that's broadcasting in stereo, it will automatically switch into stereo, which is pretty much the standard for any FM tuner these days, so they don't bother saying auto anymore. Cassette, 8-track, aux, and phono, but the phono is not for a modern turntable with a magnetic cartridge. It's for the turntables and record changers that were popular at the time this was new, which had a ceramic cartridge, which is pretty much the same level as a line level aux input, so you can actually use the phono input as another line level input for like a CD player or connecting it to an external tape deck or something. But that was originally designed for ceramic phono cartridge record players. And there's the tuning dial and a 1/4-inch stereo headphone jack. It has 4-inch speakers on the sides. I've seen some of these with cheaper looking plastic speaker grills, but this one has a metal grill, so it's a little bit fancier. And here on the back, you can see the power cord is connected to serve as the FM antenna, but if you need better antenna, you can disconnect this and connect an external FM antenna and ground. There's the phono inputs, aux inputs, tape outputs, and external speaker outputs, which use RCA jacks, which are common at the time for lower power amplifiers. So modern speakers, you just need to get some kind of adapter to convert these from RCA jacks to plain wire terminals. And there is all the information. I believe these were made in Taiwan. It is UL listed. Removing the back panel, you can see how incredibly tightly packed this thing is, but thankfully servicing it is not as much of a nightmare as it looks, because after removing a couple more screws on the bottom, you can slide out the entire chassis. So here's the chassis taken out. Thankfully the speakers in the cabinet can be unplugged from it. You can see a date code on this capacitor right here, 7940. So this was built in late 1979. There's the AM loopstick antenna. There's the 8-track mechanism, and just as I suspected, is made by Tanishin. It's the TN999SE. And here's that mechanism which gets stuck. It's the mechanism which changes the tracks on the 8-track player. And I can see a crack in the head carrier right where the screw goes in. It's a very common problem with these. So I'll have to take this out and super glue that back together and try to lubricate this mechanism so it doesn't get stuck. Here's the frequency counter for the LED display, all in the shielded metal box with what is probably input and output jacks for the RF or intermediate frequency signal. It's probably measuring that to get the frequency readout. And there's the cassette mechanism hiding behind the circuit board that contains the electronics for the cassette. There's the motor with rubber grommets to isolate the vibrations. And the belt that runs the counter is still nice and tight, but the main drive belt for the entire mechanism is definitely rather loose. So I'll either need to replace that or try boiling it again a little bit longer this time to improve its tension. And I did not add that felt pad that's there from the factory to help prevent the belt from rubbing against the mechanism. And you can see how solidly built the mechanism is. It's all metal parts, a lot of springs and levers and all sorts of stuff they were able to cheapen out in the later designs. There's the main circuit board on the bottom. It is rather discolored in the power supply section because this thing was probably left plugged in for years at a time. And unlike a regular radio or stereo system where you turn it off and the power supply shuts off, this keeps running all the time to keep the clock running. So that's why it looks rather discolored. But it's still working okay. There's the amplifier chip. It's a Toshiba TA7203P. I looked it up. I can't find a full data sheet, but according to the specifications I can find, it's rated at 2 watts per channel. There's another date code on the capacitor, 7945, so made in late 1979. Here's the problem with the 8-track player. Right now it's playing the first program. I'll hit the button to go to the next program. You can see this lever here was driven by this thing spinning around by the motor to knock it down to the next program track. Now it's playing the third program, and there's the fourth, but now it didn't advance this thing far enough, so now it just gets stuck, and I have to poke it and move it back a little bit to get it out of the way. Now it can go back to the first track. So it always gets stuck on the last track, or last program. It doesn't move that thing far enough to allow it to move back to the first track when I push the button again. So there it is. First program, second program, third program. And it just switched by itself because it came around to the end of the tape. And it got stuck. So if you fix this problem on another 8-track deck, like I said, they all use the same mechanism pretty much. So if you fix this problem and you know exactly what's wrong with this, what I need to do, please let me know in the comments. I already tried oiling this mechanism here. I put a couple drops of 3-in-1 oil in this shaft here, and that didn't help. So, if you know how to fix this, please let me know. So I don't have to open this thing up and poke it to get it to move to back to the first program. Now I'll hit the eject button. Here are the speakers. They're made by Hokutone. Never heard of that name before, but they are pretty good quality, it looks like. 4-inch drivers, 8 ohms, 2 watts. Pretty much the same thing you would see mounted in external speakers of an entry-level stereo system of the same time period as this. I forgot to show this when I had it apart, but the speed of the cassette deck is adjustable. It's kind of a crude system. They purposely made the motor run faster than it should, and then there's a screw with a spring on it which applies tension to the middle of the flywheel to slow it down to the correct speed, and you adjust the spring tension of that screw to adjust the speed. And surprisingly, even though the belt has restretched a little bit after I boiled it, it is almost exactly at the correct speed. It's supposed to be 3000 hertz, and that's pretty darn close. And you can see the wow and flutter is around 0.15 to 0.18 WRMS percent. That's what we use here in America. I know in Europe or Japan they use peak wow and flutter, which is a higher reading. I believe that's what Tecmon's meter is measuring. So his readings are usually higher than what RMS wow and flutter would be. So we can read either one here on this graph. So considering that this is a 40-year-old cassette deck, which was not high-end even in its day, and it still has its original belts, which is just boiled to do a quick fix, I think that's pretty good. Another quirk with this thing is that with most electronic clocks with an LED readout, when you first plug them in, they start flashing 12 o'clock. Now this one, it picks a time, a random time, in the 10 o'clock hour. And also, you may notice, this doesn't have AM and PM indicators, except when you set the time. See, there's the PM indicator, or I guess it could be an AM indicator, depending on however you want to do it. So it's only when you're setting the time. Let me just go back up to 12 o'clock here. See, there's the indicator, and I let go and it disappears. The AM or PM indicator only shows up when you're setting the time, and then it goes away. The clock only retains the time for a few minutes of being unplugged. Any longer than that, and you'll have to reset it because there's no battery backup. And it always starts up at approximately 10:10 or a couple minutes after that. I think that may have something to do with how analog clock dials are always shown displaying a time of 10:10 because it looks nice on the clock dial. So maybe this was trying to emulate that. So that's the 1970s in a box from IMA, a Craig company, the PS2500 from 1979.
Brothers at 91.3 FM and Flowers on the Wall. Also Petula Clark and The In Crowd, and from Crystal Gale's latest release, All My Tomorrows, we heard What'll I Do. Thanks for tuning in this morning to Permian Basin Public Radio. I'm Chad Harris, and the Capris are next with There's a Moon Out Tonight.
There's a moon out tonight.